Okay, loud, let's all gather together in the call to worship as printed in your bulletin. It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praises to your name, O Most High.
Declare your steadfast love in the morning and your faithfulness by night.
To the music of the lute and the harp, to the melody of the lyre.
For you, O Lord, have made me glad. By your work and the works of your hands, I sing for joy.
The righteous flourish like the palm tree and grow like a cedar in Lebanon.
They are planted in the house of the Lord. They flourish in the courts of our God.
Now let us all join together in the opening hymn, Immortal, Invisible, number 12 in the blue hymnal.
Thank you. Please be seated. Just a special hello to two new people that are here, Michael, who's sitting on Michelle's lap, and Barbara, who's in the back. It's great to have both of you here. So now is the time when we make our love visible through the giving of our tithes and offerings. Please let us all give with cheerful and most generous hearts. Gifts which we receive in your name, and bless also all the works of those who are in your service, from which we hope to do your will. Amen. we could join together now in the prayer hymn. Hymn number 495 in the blue hymnal, I Know Who Holds Tomorrow.
Thank you.
Let us join together in prayer. Lord God, this has been quite an intense, emotional, and challenging week for many here at this church and in this community. We ask that you calm our spirits, nurture us, and renew us, Lord. Help us to reach out despite our own concerns and seek to support those who we see around us, who it seems need greater support than our own. There is so much in this world that needs to be healed. Guide us, Lord. Open us up to your freeing words of forgiveness and gracious spirit and healing. Make us one with you and one with each other so that we may walk forward supporting our brothers and sisters who are unable to care for themselves. Open our eyes and keep them open. Open our hearts and fill them with your peace. Bind us together in your love. We pause now and pray silently for those things in our hearts and our personal needs and concerns. Today we ask for travel mercies for Phil and Teresa and family. And Lord, we come here today as our brother James has come home to you. We know that you have enfolded him with your peace and deep love. Lord, we ask that you be with Holly, to wrap her up in your loving arms, comfort her, and help her to find her way. Be also with Katie, Jen, Donovan, Eric, and the grandkids, especially Neo and Nuna and Dominic, as they seek to understand that James is with you. Lord, be with James's whole family. May this faith family and their many friends extend loving support and friendship to them ongoing. Be with this congregation also as we say farewell to James, our loved one, and seek to hold him in our hearts. Lord, we mourn for the family of Shane Harris and his families, and we ask that you watch over Christine Bullard, especially Shane's sister, Melanie, as they mourn the very sudden loss of Shane. Their lives have been uprooted and they feel adrift and torn apart. Comfort them, Lord, in this most difficult time. Be with the whole family and their many friends and loved ones and guide them into loving memories and shared stories. Help them to support each other and to find comfort in you, Lord. We ask that you be with Eva Wilson as she continues to recover from her fall. Bring her into healing that she may be well supported going forward by family and friends. Keep her safe, Lord. We ask that you be with Joyce Davis, who was suffering from an arrhythmia and had a watchman implanted this week. Bring her into full healing, Lord, and be with her and her family. And be also with Cher as she recovers from her procedure. We ask that you bring her into full recovery and bless her with deep calming. Watch over her, Lord. We ask for continued healing for Monique and continued healing for Juliet. We ask that you be with Jackson. We're grateful that he has a diagnosis, but Lord, we know Lyme disease is very challenging, and we ask that you bless his health and the road before him. We ask that you please be with Gracie Hale, who is just 4 years old and very sick. We ask that you bring her into your healing. Be with Jeff and Sandy and Gracie's whole family, Lord. We ask that you watch over all the people on the roads, especially this week, the motorcyclists as they travel to special events. Lord, keep them safe. We ask also that you continue to be with Jamel Gravely and to bring him into healing as he seeks to heal his infected finger and his hand. Be with him and Ava and their family and his medical team, Lord. We ask also that you be with Frank this morning as he is in the ER with a tick bite. Lord, be with him. Bless his health. And we ask that you be with Julia today as she is not feeling well and has missed the service. Lord, bless her. We pray these things and offer them up today in your name. Amen. Let us pray. We praise and thank you, Lord Jesus, for being present among us and in us. In us you praise God with the voice of the Spirit, whom you have given to us. Lord, we ask that this voice of the Spirit be roused as we listen to words of Scripture and to what might be revealed to each of us. We ask that you make us ready to respond to your teachings and the examples proposed to us. Amen. Rhonda? It's a long walk from the back. Take your time.
It's a good walk.
It is a good walk. The first reading this morning is from 1 Samuel chapter 15, verses 34, and then 16, verse 13. Then Samuel left for Ramah, but Saul went up to his home in Gibeah of Saul. Let our Lord command his servants here to search for someone who can play the harp. He will play when the evil spirit from God comes upon you, and you will feel better. Oops, I think I read the wrong one. Sorry about that. 13. So Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And from that day the Spirit of the Lord came upon David in power. Samuel then went to Ramah. Our second reading is Mark chapter 4, verses 26 through 34. In the days of Abiathar the high priest, he also said, this is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces grain. First the stalk, then the head, then the full kernel in the head. As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it because the harvest has come. Again he said, what shall we say the kingdom of God is like? Or what parable shall we use to describe it? It is like a mustard seed, which is the smallest seed you plant in the ground. Yet when planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds of air can perch in its shade. With many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them, as much as they could understand. He did not say anything to them without using a parable, but when he was alone with his own disciples, He explained everything.
Thank you, Lord, for the gift of your sacred word, and thank you, Rhonda. I wrote this first line well before I felt so tired today. Sometimes we need a little pick-me-up. Sometimes we need a happy tale to balance out the weightiness of our souls. This week has been a weighty one for sure. It's also been somewhat mind-boggling and surreal. How can this be? Words we often uttered. Is there an answer? Another set of words we often utter. Not understanding what is happening is a common thread in our faith and in our scriptures. Consider the disciples, mostly confused most of the time. And remember Nicodemus from 2 weeks ago and how much his head was spinning because he could just not understand what Jesus was talking about. Much of what Jesus says and does, and honestly, much of what happens in our God-given lives, is hard to understand. Often, just making it through the day leaves a lot of unanswered questions. And our minds spin, and we think, how can this be? We wonder, how will I make it through tomorrow? So today, I'm going to paint a picture per se, one that is light and joyful, that we need so much during a week in which we're saying farewell to friends and loved ones. A painting that hopefully will remind each of us of the importance of celebrating our everyday with each other. Now, as many of you know, Gabby graduated just over 2 weeks ago from UVM. It was a joyful achievement, but it was not painless or easy. It was a long 4 years for her parents and herself, probably especially for Stephen. I don't think he slept much. After our wonderfully celebratory graduation time together, Pastor Stephen and I came back to Brattleboro and the girls stayed in Burlington. Gabby had to move a day and a half after graduation, so there was no time for her to come home. A very huge flaw in the apartment setup in Burlington, and her sister stayed with her to help her and visit with friends. So in other words, Stephen and I were alone and we could relax. A few days later, he suggested a walk to the park for sort of a picnic to relax. And of course, a cigar, sorry, I know. But it was a celebration after all, and talk of candy that he put out there made the thought easier as it wove into our conversation, and I envisioned a specific chocolate bar. So as we were crossing the street from our apartment to go to the co-op to buy this chocolate bar, Stephen suddenly turned to me all wide-eyed and said, "Did we turn off the gas?" A very reasonable question which has come up frequently lately and immediately made me wonder. So I did say, I will run up and check, and I went off because leaving the gas was a thing. When I returned, he hadn't gotten much further on our walk to the co-op. He was loitering, looking at posters in the Latches theater window. And he goes, "Hey, let's just get our candy in here. Let's just ask." And I thought of resisting because it didn't seem quite right to get candy if we weren't seeing a movie. And he said, "You can have Twizzlers." And my day just got even better. A fresh pack of Twizzlers is a fantastic feast for me. And I decided I would just go with the flow and see what would unfold, which was a big task for a control freak like me who wants to be able to anticipate that next moment. So we made our way gingerly into the mostly empty theater lobby and asked if we could just get candy. "Sure," the guy said. And then Stephen goes, "How about popcorn?" And I said, "No, I do not want to carry popcorn all over town." Then Stephen upped the stakes. hey, can we just pop into the theater and sit down for a second? We haven't been in since before the epidemic. Sure. Well, what time is the next showing? 7. He turned to me and goes, come on, Terry, let's just go in and sit down. Now, as we were walking in, suddenly the candy man walked in front of us and shooed out two people that were wandering aimlessly in this theater. And I turned to this man and I said, if we weren't already married, I would think he was proposing. And he giggled and left with a wide grin. So we went in and sat in our favorite pre-COVID seats and proceeded to have our indoor picnic, all alone in this beautifully redone theater, when suddenly the screen lit up. Oh no, we have to go, said Stephen. Right, let's go, I said, and I jumped up. Wait, let's just see what it is. I go, oh no, that made me really uncomfortable. We have to go, we did not pay for the movie. We have to get up and go, because we're the only ones in here. Nope, can't stay. He goes, come on. So I sat there, rules bothering me, until suddenly the screen flashed with a still scene from Mamma Mia. One of my all-time favorite movies. Did I say all-time favorite? All-time favorite movie. Well, then my head started to kind of explode. It was already perplexed, began to spin. What's going on? What's happening here? All these questions in the flash of a second, and then suddenly I got it. I very slowly turned to Stephen, and I go, I know what's going on. Somehow he finally made good the promise from years ago that he would watch Mamma Mia with me, and my heart just started to burst and my head spun and I gushed all over him. It was very romantic. I couldn't believe it. I could barely believe that this was happening. So excited, settled in, 10 minutes in to this movie, two silhouettes come walking down the side balconies onto the stage. And I thought, are they camera people? How weird. Are they dancers? Did Stephen pay someone to do the dances from Mamma Mia on the stage? Are they going to sing these songs to us? I just couldn't figure out what was going on. But one of the profiles looked oddly familiar, and I thought, oh my gosh, I know that haircut. And then I could simply not comprehend what was going on, and I actually felt like I was losing my mind. I said, am I having an out-of-body experience? Did I have a stroke? I honestly was thinking that I lost it. Didn't make any sense. Suddenly realized that Stephen had set up this evening, weeks before, showing Mamma Mia privately, and the two girls came back. Well, I was thinking they were still in Burlington, because honestly, Gabby called me on the phone and told me about an argument she was having with her apartment mate. Just 20 minutes before we left. It didn't make sense, but it was the most wonderful evening of singing and dancing with my girls right there. We got up on the stage and danced in front of the screen. We sung as loud as we wanted. We hugged, we laughed. We even got Pastor Stephen to dance. I won't tell you about that. It was pure joy, just crazy wild joy. And I hadn't experienced that in a long time. So thank you very much. It was a day I will never forget. We planned it for weeks, and amazingly, I had no idea. I didn't even pick up on any of the clues, like why he kept singing Dancing Queen over and over again, not knowing the rest of the lyrics. He just said those two words over and over again. It was just beyond my comprehension, and it still is, sort of. He really got me, which is amazingly hard to do. So that day, the question, how did this happen, had a happy, happy answer. It was a wonderfully light and joyful distraction from the world. And I thought of that a lot this past week. Pastor Stephen and I have one of our many sayings, which is, don't wait for Paris, something a friend of ours told us years ago. We've told that story before, so I won't go into it. But it means to live each day to the fullest, because you don't know, like the song said, what tomorrow will bring. Don't wait to go on that special trip to Paris. Don't wait to say, I love you. Don't wait to call that friend. Don't wait to make that visit or send that card. Just don't wait. Why? Because we don't know what tomorrow will bring. This lesson was learned anew this past week as we bid farewell to two great friends. Life is a mystery, and we just don't know what will happen yet next, so we have to celebrate our moments together. And what happens after this life is also a mystery. We want to know. We want to be certain about the afterlife. We want to know what it will be like to be in God's presence. What happened to our loved one? What will happen to me? Each of us have tender questions that we can't utter out loud about life eternal, about how we'll be greeted by God. But Jesus gives us hints, just like Pastor Stephen tried to with me and I missed it. But Jesus can't fully explain the mystery because it's beyond our comprehension. In the scripture that Rhonda read today, Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how." He does not know how. We do not know how. Sometimes we are lucky, and we hear some explanation from Jesus or from our experiences in life, but usually not. We have no answer as to how or why did this happen. We were asked that a lot this week. And that has to be okay. We can only point to a mystery that is beyond our comprehension, one that makes our heads spin. We need to get comfortable with not understanding everything, with there being things beyond our comprehension, beyond our ability to control. Instead, we need to focus on what we do know, what we do understand, that this same mystery that we can't comprehend can make our hearts full, full of peace and full of love, full of trust in our God. After all, Jesus does explain clearly in the Bible, in the gospel, how to connect with our mysterious God daily, how in each moment we can feel the steadfast, unconditional love, the everlasting peace, the freeing grace, the forgiveness of our God. When we are overwhelmed and when life seems out of control, when we can't understand why or how, we must remember that's okay. The mystery that is God is with us and knows. The mystery that is God is wrapping love and peace around us in each moment. Let yourself be comforted. Let yourself be loved. Someday, when we are with the Lord ourselves, we will understand. But until then, we have our faith to bring us through. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, we ask that you help us to do what is right in your eyes, so that we may walk ever closer toward your glorious salvation. May every day of our lives in you be filled with joy in our hearts and a song on our lips. Amen. If we could join together now in the closing hymn in the blue hymnal, hymn number 493, we'll understand it better by and by.
Thank you.
Let us leave these walls renewed with blessings, and in the understanding that Jesus stands before us always with open arms to carry us through each and every day and lead us into true life. Now let us go forth and share our message of the risen Christ in our lives with all of our fellow sisters and brothers. Now go in peace, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.